What's up, Liron here. Today I want to show you the most common mistake I see in watercolor painting and how to fix it. What's up, Liron here. Thank you for joining me in another video. And today I want to show you really one of the most common mistakes I see in watercolor paintings, especially with beginners. This is more of a beginner mistake, not really an intermediate mistake, and that is being inaccurate with the values. And this can go in one of two directions. And the first one is not pushing them to be as dark as they should be, or what I had to deal with for a few months until I finally figured it out that I was doing it, pushing it to be too dark. And both of these pose a few problems. Now, let me give you just a basic framework of how I approach this. I like to paint in the realist, in the impressionistic style with a bit of a kick of realism, okay? So I like to stay loyal to the values and the way I see them, and the drawing should be accurate in my style and what I enjoy looking at. But I can play around with the colors, the composition. A lot of things can be changed and moved around, but I do want it to be rooted in some level of realism, especially when you take a few steps back from the painting. And so my approach is to try and match the value properly. Now, if you're trying to do something else, if you're trying to push the values on purpose, whatever it is, as long as it's deliberate and you know what you're doing, I have no issues with it whatsoever. So I'm trying to put this from my own frame of mind of trying to get the values to be accurate, and also allowing yourself the possibility to have a large range of values, okay? Because what you're gonna see is that some of these mistakes won't allow you to get the variance you're looking for, and other mistakes will not be mistakes depending on your work process, okay? So with that being said, I think we can get started, and let me show you what I mean by that. Let's get started with the demo. Okay, so first I want to show you what I got here. I painted the same scene exactly the same way. Okay, some minor differences in the flow of water. You can't do it 100% replica, but it's very similar. Just so that we understand the scene at hand, we have a castle, we have some trees here, we have the sky. Now, this is the first wash, and what I want to show you is very common mistakes that are done on the second wash. So I'm going to show you two incorrect ways of doing this and one correct way. Now, of course, when I say correct and incorrect, there are some nuances that I want you to tune into because it depends on what your next move is, okay? But I will explain everything. So we're going to start off and I'm going to zoom in on each one of those, and I'm going to show you two incorrect ways and one way that I think works a little better. So with that being said, let's zoom in on this one and get started. So let's start with the first common mistake that I see a lot of people make, especially beginners to watercolor painting, and that is not pushing the contrast to be dark enough, okay? So I'm going to show you, and I'm just going to start painting. So the light comes from here. These are all objects that are in the shadow, okay? And this is very common, and I literally saw exactly what I'm doing now. So I'm shading this right now. I'm adding a bit of a darker layer, but it's barely doing anything. Now, I do want to, this is where I want to provide some a nuance here, because if you're going to glaze on top of that another layer and shade it more, that's perfectly fine. Some people prefer to work in glazes, but I have seen a multitude of people that will just put in that second wash and that will be everything. They won't add anything. So let me show you what happens. So I'm going to put that in. And this all is in the shadow, so it kind of goes like this. I'm going to grab just a bit more paint, and I want to keep it light on purpose. It pains me to do so, but I have to for the demonstration's sake. So this is the shadow. Okay, this is my shadow for this entire castle. And I'm using a very light wash, as you can see here, very watered down. And the problem with that is I didn't create enough of a variation, so the sense of three-dimensionality isn't achieved the way I would want it, at least, okay? So it's very important to sometimes just observe the reference photo very carefully and try and nail the contrast to be accurate. Now, if you're gonna add to that, again, that's perfectly fine, but I have seen many artists that this is as dark as they're willing to push it. And that's just a shame because all of the magic is in the shadows, okay? So that's the first example I wanted to give you. Now what I want to do, and I believe there was a very gentle shadow here as well. So now what I want to do is move on to the next one and show you what happens when you do the other way around and make things too dark. So the next mistake is something a little less common, but I had a lot of trouble with that, and that is pushing the shadows too dark, to be too dark. Now I'm going to show you, of course, the reference photo. Hopefully you see it somewhere, and you can tell when you look at the where the wall turns from light to dark, you can tell, oh, this is such a big difference. So what I was tempted to do is try and put in a very strong shadow, and I would go like this, okay, and this would be probably as dark as I would go as dark as what you see here. And I was like, and when I look at the reference, I'm like, it's really dark, so let me darken it up. So I would darken it up, and I would be very excited. By the way, sorry if I'm less charismatic, because I have to paint while talking, which is a bit of a challenge, but in any case, I would be so happy when I'd get a nice contrast and the light conditions, and things would feel like they're popping because of the shadow that I'm putting in. But what I wasn't realizing is that this is way too dark, and it's very easy to get confused, especially when working outside from direct observation. It is so easy to get confused and think that things are darker. I'm gonna be fair and be correct here, and I'll get this shadow here under the tower, and I'm gonna put in this. There's a bit of noise from the outside. Hopefully you can still hear me well. I'm gonna get these bits of details here. Now, let me tell you what the main problem, in my opinion, with this approach is. Okay, aside from the fact that you aren't sometimes able to control the wash very well because it's super dry, so it's hard for the paint to move and you have to work really fast, otherwise you're gonna mess it up. Aside from that fact, the main issue is that we left no room for the darks, like the real shadows. We have no way of exploiting them now that we've went directly into the darkest value. Oop, I made a mistake here, but I can correct it. Now that we went to the darkest value we could produce here, or close to that, we don't have enough room to exploit some wet in wet, maybe get some details inside the shadows. And it's so funny to me because I was making this mistake, exactly what I'm showing you right now. I did it so many times. I'm gonna move the palette, it's in my way. I was doing this thing wrong for so many times. And there's a bit of a shadow here under the rooftop, and I'll be like, oh, okay, that looks nice, but something's a little off and I can't tell what it is. And now I know what it is. I just went super dark and unnecessarily. So now you don't get any, it's like a black and white photo, not even grayscale, black and white. You have light, you have dark, and now go figure what the thing is. So it's too bad, because I do see some make that mistake. Usually I used to do that, but it's much less common than the previous mistake, but still very common. So now I'm gonna show you the middle ground and why I think it's so productive and correct to work that way. Now, I will again give a slight nuanced point here. It all depends on the reference. If this is the contrast that you recognize on the reference, then by all means, get that contrast in. What I see people do is they don't notice that the dark isn't as dark as they think. And on the contrary, they will also blow up the highlights, making them white and characterless and no color. Okay, so that's another important point. So now we're finished with this example. And again, if you look at the reference photo that I'm gonna put somewhere here, it is darker, but it's not as dark. You have so much variation and variety in the shadow. Now, of course, I want to be completely fair. The light part of the walls, in my example, is lighter than the reference. I did it on purpose to further accentuate the contrast. I know that, I'm aware of that. All of these walls should be a little darker, but for the sake of example, I wanted to show you this is much too dark, especially if you go relative, okay? Now I'm gonna show you the happy medium way of doing that, so I'm just gonna rearrange some stuff here. Okay, so if we were to do this right, first I'm gonna water down what I got here significantly. I'm also probably gonna add a bit of yellow to mute it down a little, and I have my test paper just to make sure I get it right. So this is a bit more like it. This is something that I think will work better. I'm gonna add a bit more water just to keep the paint moving a little more. I'm gonna start putting in the paint. Now I'll try not to do too much variation, because that'll be cheating and adding interest by other means. So all I'm gonna do is play around with the values. So here we've got this. Now another advantage to not going too dark and probably not too soon as well, is that because of the wetness of the wash, you can still do some wet in wet. So for example, if I recognize that the tower in the background is a little darker, I can put in some wet paint onto the already wet area, like so. And that way I can even further separate the shape of the rooftop here. That's a little red, but I'm not gonna cheat again. I'm not gonna do that. But I can put a bit of darkness here. And now the shape of this rooftop came out using the darkening of the areas around it. Okay, so I hope that makes sense. And then we have this rooftop that's quite dark. So I'm gonna use a bit of a darker paint here. I'm just trying to get the values to be a little more on point. And I'm gonna go back to my very watered down wash, because this wall under this rooftop part is a little lighter. Okay, I'm gonna put it down like that. And now I get enough of a wiggle room to play around with the actual value. It may seem similar to the previous example, and of course watercolor will dry a little lighter, but now at least we got the contrast to be a little more accurate. And most importantly, and you will see when this dries, is that we have the ability to come back with a bit of a drier brush and actually bring out some details in the shadows, okay? I'm gonna do that now. Got this wall a little wobbly, but that's fine. And I wanna show you something else cool. We can come back, let's say, with this rigger brush here and grab some very, very thick paint and maybe even get a bit of that hint of a strong shadow here under the rooftop and even here, okay? Because we have some room to play with the values. So I'm gonna finish this wall. The roof here and the wall are similar value. Put this one here. Now this is, I think, one of the best examples of this, and you'll see in just a moment. So I finished with this wall, and now I want you to see how much more I can play with the shadows inside the shadows. This is really important, and if you let it dry for just a few moments so that the color will disperse just enough, not too much, but just enough, you can start adding details into the shadow that'll actually make this look really good, like windows here. I'm gonna add a few like this. And now you can see, and here I barely left any room for that kind of play because I killed off all of the, you know, there is no place for variation. Here I can put a bit of details here and there. Maybe this wall at the back is a little darker. You know, I can do whatever I want with it. Add a few windows here. And now I get a much more interesting, I think, in my opinion, contrast and values in a way that actually works out, okay? Now, I wanna zoom out and just conclude this and say a few words, you know, because there are a few nuanced points here as well, but I'll just maybe get a few indications of the shadow of this window here. Here I didn't do them, but I should have probably showed this in the other examples as well. Just a few windows and details, doesn't really matter. And also I completely missed that shadow that should be very dark. I'm gonna show you what I mean here. This is a dark shadow to indicate the shape of the wall. And now I can do so much with it. I can still play around with it. It's still a bit wet. I could decide that I darken this spot here, this entire gap between the two towers. I can darken it and then it sends it to the back. But you see, I have a lot more room to play around with the values. Okay, so let's zoom out a bit and conclude this. And of course, I wasn't as accurate, like for example, this side here to the left. Let me just add one last touch. You know, with watercolor, it's hard to stop. But this part of the rooftop is a little red and darker. So that is important to get here. I didn't get it on the other parts, but here that I can actually get the variance that I want in values, I could actually do that. Maybe pick up some of the paint and here we go. So now let's zoom out and conclude this. So there you have it. The two common mistakes with values is just getting them too light or too dark. This now started to dry completely and you can barely see any variance. Let me hold it up close to the camera. You can barely see anything. This one's too dark and I can't add anything. It's too strong of a contrast. And granted, we don't have the context because I haven't shaded the foliage and everything, but still you get it. And here there's much more room to play in the shadows, okay? Now again, one last, I think two disclaimers. First,
If you plan on doing working in glazes and this is just one of multiple glazes, that's perfectly fine. You'll add the next layer and darken things up a little more. Me personally, I love to be more direct with my style, so I would prefer to get all the variants on the first or second go, like in this example. And with this, I would say you want to avoid doing too sharp of a contrast. But if that's the contrast in the reference photo and you strive to mimic that accurately, then that is perfectly fine as well. Okay, so that's my disclaimer for you. It all depends on the reference and how you're going to continue working on the painting. For me personally, I love to do the more realistic type of impressionism where I actually try and imitate what I see with my own impression of it, with my own personal twist, with my own style. So this is what I like to do the most. So I do aim for a high level of accuracy in the values. Like you see here, that's a little more accurate. Now, of course, this whole scene is off because I didn't do this exactly the same as in the reference. In the reference, it's a little darker, but that's still fine. Just for the demonstration's sake, I lightened everything up for you, okay? Even these shadows are a little lighter than the reference, because this is lighter, so I'm doing it relational to the changes I already made. So I hope this makes things clearer. It takes time to get a grasp of values and how to do them properly, but I hope this at least brings it to your attention. And now we can wrap up this video, and I'll reiterate some of the points, and then we will say goodbye for now until the next one.
So this is it. I really hope you enjoyed seeing this one. I just want to again reiterate, I know I talked about it a few times, again, if your style is working slowly in glazes, building things up as you go along, feel free to do that and continue doing that. That's perfectly fine. It's a work method. That's how you like doing things. That's perfectly fine. If you like to push the contrasts to be a little more punchy, that's also fine. Whatever matches your vision and what you enjoy doing the most. If you're like me and you're trying to get them to be accurate, I would try and stay loyal to them and try and get them to look right. So this is a good measuring stick to see. Are you pushing it too dark? Are you being too timid and afraid to go dark enough? Okay, everyone has to deal with their own issues, and that's fine. Takes time, takes practice. I'm in it for now, like 5 years almost, and I'm still learning new things with every piece of art that I make, which is incredible. I love watercolor for that reason. So in any case, I hope you enjoyed this one. I will put in the bottom of the video a link to my beginner's drawing course, so you definitely want to check that out if you're struggling with the drawing part, okay? If this is something that's hard for you to get accurate, and a good drawing basis can be important for painting depending on your style and what you want to do. So I would definitely recommend you check it out. Now, if you want to hear me talk about more heady stuff like creativity and art and my journey as an artist trying to build a brand and a business around their art, I would highly recommend you check out my podcast, also linked in the description box below. All the links are in the description box below. I'm also writing down the list of tools I'm working with, things like this that I think will really help you. I want to thank you so much for tuning in and listening. I really, really appreciate it. If this happens to be the first video of me that you check out, be sure to subscribe, because there's tons of other exercises and tutorials and guides and full painting processes. So all I'm trying to do is give you as much value as possible. So let me know if there's anything else you want me to cover, anything else you want me to talk about, and I will see you again in another vid real soon.